Hello, and welcome back to California Geology. I am Dr. Robert Lopez, your professor for this course. Today I want to focus on the upper mantle and the crust. So let's look at the document camera here, and we see that we have a couple of words here, lithosphere and asthenosphere. We'll get to those words, but first we want to talk about looking within Earth away again. So remember, seismic waves are like x-rays that we can look inside the Earth, especially the velocity of the P wave. When P waves move through rocks or through layers in the Earth, they change velocities. When they encounter harder material, they'll speed up. When they encounter weaker material, they'll slow down. One thing that scientists know is that in the crust, the velocity of the P wave in the continental crust is 6 kilometers per second. In ocean crust, it's a little bit faster at 7 kilometers per second. Remember, it's a little bit more dense. It's 3.0 versus 2.7 grams per centimeter cube here. But then universally, whether you're under ocean basins or you're under continental crust, the velocity skipped to 8 kilometers per second. And so this was first discovered by a scientist named Mohorovicek, a Yugoslavian scientist, in the early 1900s. And so collectively, we abbreviate this. Geologists call this the MOHO. I want you to know that the MOHO, this boundary between crust and mantle, so that means anything down over here going this way is mantle, right? So this would be the mantle. Whereas the crust would be all this up here. So either continental crust or oceanic crust over here, right? So we discovered the crust mantle boundary. And with that, we find that on average, continental crust is about 35 kilometers. It can vary anywhere from 10, 15 to about 50 kilometers or more than 50, but on average, we'll say about 35 kilometers. Whereas for oceanic crust, we find that MOHO down around 7 kilometers. So that'd be the average thickness for oceanic crust. Note that ocean seawater, the depth is anywhere from 4 to 5 kilometers deep, right? So this region up here, we call this the uppermost mantle. Uppermost mantle. And this uppermost mantle is composed of a rock called peridotite. Peridotite. And peridotite is important for several reasons, but it is the rock of the mantle. We can't really find it up here on Earth's surface, but volcanoes, lava, especially these mafic or basalt lava eruptions, have brought pieces or fragments of the mantle up with them. So these are inclusions, or we call these xenoliths, foreign rocks brought up with these volcanic eruptions, little pieces of the mantle. You'll see that there's this green mineral called olivine, and olivine is the primary mineral that makes up the rock peridotite, the mantle rock. We'll say more about this later on. Now, another interesting thing that happens is once seismic waves go through the uppermost mantle, they encounter a weak layer where seismic waves either slow back down to 7 kilometers per second, in some cases down to 6 kilometers per second. But there's a clear slowdown. So seismologists call this a low velocity zone, low velocity, which means that the seismic waves are encountering something weak. And so geologists call this layer the asthenosphere. The asthenosphere. Note that this asthenosphere lies directly under the mantle lithosphere and the continental crust, right? And where this velocity change occurs, under ocean basins, it's about 70 kilometers down. Under continental crust, it's about 130 kilometers down. And that gives us an important window. We've discovered something here. If we look at the thickness of this crust plus the uppermost mantle, this is what we call continental lithosphere. continental lithosphere. And this lithosphere is basically a tectonic plate. In fact, let's do the ocean lithosphere. So ocean lithosphere would be this section over here. So let's put ocean lithosphere. So there's continental lithosphere and ocean lithosphere. If we go back down over here, note that the lithosphere is crust and uppermost mantle, right? It's the rocky sphere of Earth, right? More importantly, this lithosphere, these are the tectonic plates. These are the tectonic plates. So now, using these earthquake waves, the velocity of P waves, we've discovered how thick they are. Continental tectonic plates, like the North American tectonic plate, is about 130 kilometers thick, whereas oceanic plate, like the Pacific tectonic plate, is about 70 kilometers thick. So there we go, we've discovered this thickness. Now, as we keep going down around maybe 200 kilometers under ocean basins and about 225 kilometers under continents, is we find another fast velocity zone. In other words, the seismic waves start increasing their speed again. And so now, obviously, we're back to really hard, strong rock. And so this is going to be the lower mantle, right? It's strong. And we start increasing that density. Remember, the mantle ranges from about 3.3 to 5.7 going down. And also note that this lower mantle, well, you know, we've only gone 225 kilometers down to the asthenosphere. We still have about maybe 2,700 kilometers to go, because remember, the mantle is 2,900 kilometers thick, right? So we're only looking at the very most uppermost parts of the mantle in this region here. But the key thing is this asthenosphere lying directly beneath the lithosphere, right? These tectonic plates. So let's go down here, and I have this asthenosphere. The asthenosphere is kind of a strange substance. It's called a viscoelastic. In other words, it kind of flows like something very viscous. It slowly oozes and behaves like a liquid, but it's elastic, meaning it's like if you stretch a rubber band and then let go, it's a solid that can kind of be moved around. It kind of rebounds to its original shape. And one example of a viscoelastic substance is silly putty, right? Silly putty, you can stretch it, right? You can stretch it. So it behaves like a liquid, right? Behaves like a liquid. So if you do it very slowly, that's going to happen. But if I were to do this very rapidly, I can break it. You see this clean break? It breaks like a solid, right? So the mantle, or at least the asthenosphere, this weak sphere of Earth, behaves in this fashion. It behaves, the key thing, it has the ability to flow. So the asthenosphere flows, right? Because of this viscoelastic nature, right? So again, the key, the lithosphere lies directly over the asthenosphere. And then here's the good part here. Asthenosphere provides the lubrication for plate tectonics. So we've set the stage here. Now the next thing I want to point out here are the three basic concepts of plate tectonics. The three basic concepts of plate tectonics. The first one is that we have these, there are rigid tectonic plates. And these rigid tectonic plates, remember, they're the lithosphere. That rocky sphere of Earth, the crust plus uppermost mantle. The other thing we know about these is that they move. So we'll say tectonic plates move with respect to one another. To one another. And we know this. We've felt this movement through earthquakes. The ground shakes, moves beneath our feet. And remember, they're sliding on that asthenosphere, the lithosphere sliding on the asthenosphere. Number three is that most deformation, remember, the word tectonic in parts means deformation, right? Movement and deformation. Most deformation occurs at plate tectonic boundaries. Sometimes we call these margins. Margins. So plate tectonic margins, plate tectonic boundaries. And so our next talk will be on those three types of margins. So far we've discovered the thickness of crust. So remember, ocean crust is about 7 kilometers. Continental crust is about 35 kilometers. Using seismic waves, again, we've discovered the thickness of ocean tectonic plates or ocean lithosphere, which is about 70 kilometers thick, whereas continental tectonic plates are about 130 kilometers thick. All right, we'll stop here and we'll see you next time.